right, we're glad you're here with us this morning. Let's all stand. We'll start with Jesus Saves. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Good to see all of you here. You glad you're here? Say amen.
Amen.
Wonderful. I am so glad you're here. I trust you've had a good week. Have you? Had a good week? Boy, it's been a gorgeous week, hasn't it? Pretty week. Wonderful week. Some of you not responding. Got good news for you. If you had a bad week, today starts a new week. You got a great, great outlook because you're starting it in a good spot. Amen. Start the week off right. Start it in church. Boy, I'd help you. Really will. I'm glad you're here. So thankful for God's touch on your life and what God wants to do. And boy, I'm telling you, in the right spot to hear that today and to feel that today and have God speak to us today. And I'm thankful for what God is going to do. What he wants to do. He's an awesome God. I'm telling you, I've seen him do great things, and he's still in the miracle working business in our lives, in our hearts and situations, and I'm glad he wants to work with us today. Thank you, Lord, for being here with us today. Let's thank him, let's praise him, and let's pray together. All right, Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the privilege to come into your house, this wonderful place you blessed us with, allowed us to come and gather together in your name. What a great opportunity we have to meet with you and you with us and to hear from you and learn more about you and to be touched by your presence in our presence. Lord, there's nothing like it, and I want to thank you for it. I want to thank you, Lord, for each one who's here. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege to join together collectively to adore you and worship you and praise you and think about what you've done for us. And Lord, my, what it does to our hearts when we stop and realize how much you love us, how much you care for us, what you did in sending your son to die on the cross for us. Lord, as we approach this Easter time and celebration of, Lord, your death, burial, and resurrection, I pray, oh God, that you just take over this service and everything be done for your glory and your honor and your praise. Lord, may we just worship you here this morning. That's what it's all about, and honor you in such a marvelous way. We'll be careful to praise you and thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, let's just go to worship. Come on, Brother Daniel. One.
Thank you.
3:46, we're going to sing the first, and then the choir will come down, and we'll sing the last together. Okay.
I call a lot of audibles, and that's what I'm doing now, and they love it. When I change it up on them, they love it. I love the way she plays this song, and this is just a great song. What a friend we have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? Don't get discouraged. We should never be discouraged. We have a friend. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can you find a friend so faithful? Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
a load of care. Precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there.
Thank you, Sister Paige. Wonderful. If you have your Bibles, open them to the book of Matthew. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 27. Matthew, chapter number 27. I've been in a conference this week, training conference this week, and been trying to look at the Word of God in between whatever and thinking about different things. And I was listening to a sermon at night by a man who's in glory now, Brother John Phillips. And then I was gathering some other thoughts this week at night in the room and just talking and trying to come up with what the Lord would have us look at this morning. Matthew's Gospel, chapter number 27. I want to draw out of this these verses a thought, and try to use these verses to look at the cross and look at Calvary and talk to you about that this morning. If you're able and can stand with me, I'm going to read a few verses, skip a few verses, read some more verses, and we'll get our thought for this morning. Matthew chapter 27, begin reading with verse number 45. The Bible says, "Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Now look down at verse number 50, verse number 50. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, he's probably making another saying, which is not recorded here by Matthew, but by one of the other Gospels. When he had made that saying, yielded up the ghost, and behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose. Now look at verse 53. And came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many. Verse 54. Now when the centurion, the soldier, and they that were with him, watching Jesus, saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. Let's pray. Father, I want to ask you now to open our hearts and our minds, harness us, Lord, our attention. Everything we have going on in our lives, take away for a few moments. And Lord, help us to surrender upon Calvary for a few moments, upon the cross for a few moments. And Lord, help us to see what you have for us today from your holy word, that event that took place many, many years ago, and help us to marvel once again and see what you did for us there. And may we be captivated, may we be changed by what we see today, what the Holy Spirit does in our hearts today, not just in our minds. And we'll be careful to praise you for all you do in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
just about over 2,000 years ago, of course, on a skull-shaped heel. It gets its name, of course, from Luke's Gospel and Matthew's Gospel. Outside the city wall of Jerusalem, Matthew tells us that Jesus was crucified on a place called Golgotha. Luke tells us, of course, the name in Latin means, or is Calvary. It means a place of the skull. It gets its name, believed to be a skull-shaped hill, rise there in Jerusalem, outside the city wall, in a place that resembled a skull. You have pictures today and taken years ago when my dad went to the Holy Land. He has a picture, and now you go to the tomb there, believed to be where the body of the Lord Jesus laid, and there, just a little ways from there, is believed to be the very hill where they took Jesus up there and crucified him on a main thoroughfare of that day, just off of that main thoroughfare, and a little hill. It was a small hill, not very size, not very high from topology, topographically, wasn't a very high hill, but it was a hill that people could see, look up and see, of course, a crucifixion going on. You come to understand that theologically and spiritually, although physically it wasn't a very big hill, it was the highest hill in human history that Jesus died upon that day, because his death changed all of history. That day when Jesus, the Son of God, the very God, man himself, came into this world and yet died there on Calvary, it was a unique day, and never before had there anyone died like he died, because he was God in the flesh. He sojourned upon this earth for over 33 years, stepping out of eternity, taking upon himself the flesh of a man and walking upon this earth. And he lived uncomparably to anyone else who had walked upon this earth. That is, he lived without sin, marvelously declaring who he was. He was the self-existent, uncreated God in the flesh, the person, the second person of the Godhead. He was that one whom angels adored, that one who angels worshiped, the creator of the rolling spheres of all of eternity and all the planets and all of earth itself. And yet, on this day, they were crucifying him. There he was, who he was. Certainly on this day, it was going to transform and change all of history. Something was happening that day. And him being who he was, who we believe he was, and who he claimed he was, you would think something would happen to declare who he was. Something would transform, something would demonstrate that this was God dying there on that hill for the sins of mankind. You expected something to happen, something for this shame to take place, this hill of shame, this mockery, something as they stood around and they jeered and they cheered some and mocked him as his blood is ebbing out of his body and as he's dying there on that cross, on that hill. You would expect something to happen. My goodness, if he is who he says he is, the death of Jesus on that cross was so unique. I mean, there'd never been anyone die like him before, because there'd never been nobody live like him before. No one had demonstrated the love that he had demonstrated. No one had walked like he had walked. No one had said the things that he had said. No one had declared that he was God in the flesh like he had, and brought to pass the miracles that he did, declaring who he was and showing forth the love of God like he had, because no one had been born like he had been born. Oh, such a day, such a death. We ought to wonder about the miracles of what would transpire. And as you study the dealings of God with humanity, you start seeing that there are miracles that transpire around major events that God brings about in history. For example, when you look at the great events of history, there are miracles. At creation, there were miracles that took place. At the Exodus, God bringing His people, His chosen people, out of Egypt's land, there were miracles that took place. When Jesus was born, there were miracles that took place. As Jesus conducted His earthly ministry and He would declare who He was, there were miracles that took place. So now when Jesus, God's only begotten Son, the very present Son of God, is dying on a hillside, you would expect something to happen that is declaring who He is. And certainly, it did. Miracles took place. If you're not careful, as you read those scriptures I just read, you overlook those miracles. You and I, we read the Gospels, we read the account of the Lord Jesus, we read the Bible, and it seems like sometime we just read it. It's a wonderful story about God and His love for us, and we overlook the magnificence of who He is and what He has done, the demonstration of who He is and how that God would declare these miracles even in His death there on that cross. So I want us to look for a few moments this morning on the miracles of Calvary, the miracles at Calvary. When Jesus is dying, there were some miracles that took place even in His death, right here in these scriptures. I want us to see, this is not an original thought, but my, how it hammered home to me as I began to study it and look at it and think about it, so many things that transpired in these miracles. I want you to see the miracle of the Son. As you look at it, the Bible says here in that first verse that I read to our hearing today, the Bible says, now from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. When the Bible reads those hours, many times some people do not understand them. But we have an eyewitness account here. An eyewitness of those that were there on that day. And the recording of God's holy word shows us what happened. The unimpeachable evidence of what transpired on that day when Jesus was crucified. The Gospels declare it from the sixth hour. The sixth hour in the Bible is 12 o'clock high. 12 noon. And the Bible says something amazing here that we know happened, but we don't take it to credit. That is, we do not dive into the depths of it or understand it to the details of what happened on that day that Jesus died on the cross. Think about it with me. The Bible says here from 12 o'clock high noon until 3 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the highest peak of when the sun is shining, it became dark. It became dark. All across the land, the Bible says, in that land until the ninth hour. About the ninth hour, Jesus cries out with a loud voice. Now, the Bible tells us this happened back and forth across every mountain, every hill, every city, every corner of that part of the country. The Bible tells us there was absolutely complete, terrifying darkness upon that country. The Bible declares. The sun refused to shine when it looked down and saw what was happening on that day. When Jesus, the creator of the universe, the creator of the sun. Now we know the sun doesn't have a personality, but as I was listening and thinking and hearing and reading about the sun itself, I thought about if it had a personality, I wonder what it would have thought that day. For 12,235 times it had come across the exploration of the Lord Jesus, God Himself, as He's walking upon this earth. Every day He had watched Him. If the Son had a personality, He would have been watching Him grow up upon this earth. He'd been watching Him do so many miracles upon this earth. He had watched Him declare who He was, knowing that He had put Him in existence, the Son. watched as he opened blinded eyes, watched as he touched lepers, and the leprosy fled away. Watched as the Lord Jesus was here upon this earth and watched over and over this wonderful Creator, the Creator of all the earth, as he was upon this earth. And now he's watching something that causes him to want to shut his eyes, or causes him to want to go totally out, not look upon the Creator of all the ends of the earth, go dark. Why? Because what they're doing to the very Son of God. He could say, I watched him do so many wonderful sights, but what they're doing now is he looks down and sees men murdering their Maker. Oh, the songwriter had it right. He talked about, oh, might the sun in darkness hide and shut the glories in when the incarnate Son of God died. Oh, for man his creature sins. It was at 3 o'clock that afternoon that the sun, caught enough courage to open up once again and look after Christ died. But during that time, it was awful. You see the sun radiance and the sun's greatness to be able to shine this brilliance. The sun is a vast sphere. I looked up these stats. Amazing, 864,000 miles in diameter, 360 quadrillion cubic miles of violet hot gas. Weighing 2 quadrillion tons. That's bigger than I can imagine. I'm not even a math student, good one. That's 2 million billion, quadrillion, sun. And yet, giving out 25 million degrees of Fahrenheit and hydrogen gas converting to helium, providing light for the world in space. And yet on this occasion, it went black in that country. Darkness came upon the countryside, the Bible said. He said what? The ninth hour, he said, it's darkness over all the land. We have eclipse upon this earth. Sometimes the planets intermingle and get in contrast to each other, and they'll block each other's sun rays upon the earth, and we'll have an eclipse. We've seen them. I guess all of us here at one time or another have seen eclipse, partial eclipse. Sometime a total, what they call a total eclipse. How long does it last? The most it'll ever last in a total eclipse is, yeah, you guessed it, 7 minutes. 7 minutes. Get out there and, well, don't look directly at it, but watch it. 7 minutes, total eclipse. And then it's gone. Watch it move across to its total, and then it starts moving on across the moon, solar eclipse. Lunar eclipse, all those things, 7 minutes. This lasted 3 hours. 3 hours. The sun didn't shine. It went dark. If you imagine that right now, sun going dark for 3 hours. Well, what would that do to you? What would that do to you? What it did to that land that day? Everybody's watching as the Christ, the Lord Jesus, is dying on that cross as this eclipse took place. No, it wasn't an eclipse. The Bible had prophesied it. Amos chapter 8 and verse number 9, the Bible says, it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord God, that I will cause the sun to go down at noon, and I will blacken the earth in the clear day. In the clear day. Sun's going to go out. 3 hours. What's God doing? He's drawing attention to what's happening on that day. The hymn writer said, well, might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in when Christ the mighty Maker died for man the creature's sin. He died for you and I. When he done his work in creation, he said, let there be light. When he done his work in redemption, he said, let there be dark. See, God's drawing attention to the very fact of what's happening. And then he said, Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why did he forsake him? Those words he spoke of the supernatural event that was transpiring when the world went black, when the darkness came. Why? We're often asked that question, why? You're often asked that question, why, as a parent? How do you answer that? Oh, many times we don't answer it correctly, of course, because I said so. Especially if we don't know all the answers. And as our kids get older now, what do you tell them? I know what I tell my grandgirls. Google it. No. But in reality, of course, why? Why Jesus died on the cross of Calvary? All the mysteries of life, all the unexplainable enigmas of life cause us to ask why. All the tragedies of life, we have them. We hear about them. The awful tragedies of sin draw us to the moment of why? And Jesus said, why have you forsaken me? Why did God the Father turn his back on his only begotten Son? Why? Habakkuk tells us, of course, God can't look upon sin. And in that very moment, God was pouring on him the wrath of sin. The sin, what sin? Your sin, my sin, the sins of the whole world. In that moment, God was putting on him the sins of the whole world, that in Calvary, he was pouring upon him the sins of the whole world, the sin of all mankind for all the ages. Oh my, that awful sin. That's the reason he was asking, why have you forsaken me? You see, in the garden, Jesus prayed, but he had the Father. You and I have the wonderful privilege of prayer. Daniel sung about it this morning. We don't often take advantage of it, but we have it, the wonderful privilege of prayer. In the garden, he prayed, Father, if it be thy will. Oh, you see, he prayed. We can pray our Father. But then he said, behold, the hour comes. The hour comes. Yea, and now it's come. He told his disciples, you'll be scattered. In the garden, he prayed, not my will, but thine be done. He prayed. And now he's experiencing on the cross something that he would experience so that you and I would never have to, although many people do. Loneliness. The loneliness of what? Not having his Father. Loneliness is a terrible thing. Abandoned by his Father. Loneliness is a terrible thing. There's a lot of people in this world who are lonely. The elderly people so many times feel all alone. Single people sometimes feel all alone. You can live in a city of thousands or millions and still feel all alone. You can be surrounded by a lot of people and still feel all alone. Oh, but what a wonderful thing to know that when Jesus was forsaken on the cross, he was being forsaken so that you would never have to be forsaken. You would never have to be alone. He was alone so that you and I would never have to experience the loneliness of being alone. That's the reason the Bible says, with that promise, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Oh, there's been times you've been left, but you haven't been forsaken. There's been times you've been forsaken, but not left. But there's never been a time, if you know the Lord as your personal Savior, that you've never been forsaken or left. He said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Somebody said the word forsaken literally means, why have you left me down in? It means that hell rolled in on that day of Calvary and descended Jesus down into the depths of hell so that he would know what it was like to be abandoned by God. That's where hell is, abandoned by God. Plus all the torment. Hell, the hell of being abandoned by God. But Jesus was there so that you would never have to experience being abandoned by God. No, never alone. Oh, I've witnessed to people, I've talked to people, I've watched people go through some awful tragedies and experience some awful, terrible things. I've witnessed and talked to people, widow women, widowers, who have been alone now for several years, many years. Some of them experienced all kinds of different things in their lives, and they said, oh, preacher, I'm here by myself, but I'm never alone. Never alone. Never alone. The songwriter had it right when he said, no, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me. Never to leave me alone. It's in that songbook. He promised never to leave me alone. I can sing that song sometime, going down the road and maybe feel a little lonely, or having been on a dreadful call and getting that car and ride and seem like nobody knows and I can't share it with anybody, but I can share it with him, and I start talking to him and say, oh, never alone, never alone. I'm glad he promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. The miracle of the sun. I hasten to say the miracle of the sanctuary. It's found right here in verse 50 and 51. The Bible said he made a loud cry. That's probably, of course, the cry from the cross when he's dying there. It's finished, maybe. And then the veil, the Bible said, the veil of the temple, that veil, that awesome veil that separated the Holy of Holies from the holy place. Oh, you see, it's amazing. Jesus on that cross and he's dying. It's not a cry of frustration. It's not a cry of defeat. It's not a cry of mourning, it's a cry of victory. It is finished. It's over, he cries. And as he dies, the Bible said that God reached down. You see, it was rent from the top to the bottom, not from the bottom to the top. And even if it was from the bottom to the top, mankind couldn't have done it. No, no, no. You see, that veil, I mentioned this last week, that veil was put together with all the different interweavings of cloth and material. It was put together and then it was tested by the oxen. Had to be pulled and tested to make sure it couldn't rip. Make sure it couldn't be sawed through. Make sure it was thick. It was thick as a man's hand. That thick. Thick as a man's hand. And it was hung inside that temple, 30 feet wide, 60 feet high. This auditorium's a little over 30 feet wide. This ceiling's about 12 feet high right down here. If you'd imagine that about five more times, you imagine how big, how powerful, how high, how vast that veil was, how awesome that veil was. You walk in that temple. Of course, you didn't walk in that temple. You and I didn't walk in that temple. Only those authorized will walk in that temple. Old Testament, you have a king who was a godly king, but yet he thought he had reached a place in his life where he could go in and make a sacrifice, and God struck him dead. Leprosy. He didn't make it to the Holy of Holies. He just made it to the outer court. This veil, 300 of the priest would handle that veil. Took 300 of them, 60 feet from top to bottom. Can you imagine that veil? And it ripped when Jesus died, ripped from the top to the bottom. God himself reached down and tore that veil open. Tore it open. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19, 20. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiness by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. Oh, it's a marvelous thing, that veil of the temple, rent from top to bottom. What an amazing, amazing feat that was. What an amazing thing it was. It was God opening up the way to him. And him saying what? Through the shed blood of my son, you can come on in now. Through the shed blood of my son. What a privilege we do have in prayer to go boldly to the throne of grace, boldly to his throne room. What a wonderful thing it is. Can you imagine how it is to come into his presence? To enter into his presence? Have you done it? Have you thought about it? Have you done it today? Entered in into his presence? Oh my. And to hear him say, come on in. How's things going? Oh, tell me about it. And to him to listen. Listen. That's an art we're missing in modern day America. Listening. Oh, and he listens. He says, wait a minute, tell me that again. You're dealing with what? What? What's your burden? What's your problem? You're carrying what? Tell me about it. How's your family? How are things going on your job? What's that you're concerned about? What's that worry you have? What's that problem you have? What's that you're troubled with? Oh, come over a little closer. Tell me about it. Oh, you see, that's the kind of God we serve. Open. He knows, but he wants us to tell him. He wants to hear. He wants us to share with him what's on our heart, what our concerns are. And then he says, what? You got to go so soon? What? When you going to be back? When you going to have this time again? Oh, the sanctuary. Here he talks about it here. Oh, the veil was rent in twain. And then the Bible talks about these stones. The miracle of the stones, verse 51. The earth did shake. The rocks tore. Can you imagine the rocks tearing? That's an amazing thing. I think about rocks tearing. We hear about earthquakes today. And to think about earthquakes and to think about the earth shaking. We know a little bit about earthquakes. We know a little bit about earth shaking. But these stones, the Bible talks about it. He puts the emphasis on these stones. Just a few days before his crucifixion, Jesus had come riding in on a donkey into this city, and people had gathered around him. And with enthusiasm, they had hollered the Messiah's. Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he, oh hallelujah. He's here, he's here. Caiaphas, that high priest, said, got him a band together, said, go out there and quiet them down. Go out there and shut them up. They went out there and surrounded the disciples of the Lord and finally got over there to him and said, tell these folks to quieten down. Tell these folks to shut up. Quit saying that. You remember what Jesus said? You can read it. The Bible said, while these folks hold their peace, the rocks cry out. They know who he is. They know it's Christ. They know who he is. He is the Son of God. He is who he says he is. He's here. Oh, but now he's hanging on that cross. Now he's dying on that cross. Now he's there. Oh, I'm telling you, why aren't they still there crying out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord? Where are they? Where are they? Where's Bartimaeus, blind Bartimaeus who's touched by the Lord, who's called, stopped on his way there into Jericho and stopped? Oh, the bow on the wayside, and called to him and said, come, come. He calleth for thee. And he healed him of his blindness. Where's he at now? Where's he at now? Jesus is dying on the cross. Where's Bartimaeus? Come, Bartimaeus. Come on, Bartimaeus. Just a few days ago that God healed you, the blind man. Where are you? Zacchaeus, why he came to your town there in Jericho, and you climbed up in the tree to see him, and Jesus stopped. And he looked up to where you were. And he said, hasten, come on down. I'll go home with you. God changed your life. I made a decent man out of you, Zacchaeus. There you was. Think about Jairus. Your daughter is laying about to die. And you go get the Lord and you get back to your house and she's already dead. Seems like everybody's lost hope. And Jesus said, not all hope is gone. I'm here. They started laughing at him. And Jesus said, tell him to get out of here. He goes up and raises that daughter of yours back to life. What about old Peter? Where's Peter? Oh, my, you should be here, Peter. You say, ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, approved of God among the miracles and wonders, signs, which God did in the midst of you. As yourself already know. He'd say that in a few days later, but where's he at now? I tell you where he's at. He's on the backside of Gethsemane over there, hiding his face and weeping because he's denied the Lord. Where are you at today? You praising the Lord for something he's done for you? Well, we ought to be. We ought to be. He's still the Savior. Oh, but on this cross, you see, they were holding their peace. On this cross, Jesus is dying. And so God said, well, let the rocks cry out. And the earthquake and the rocks rent. The Bible said, it tore. I see the miracle of the sepulchre. The Bible said there's graves and the saints were opened. Graves of the saints were opened and there were many bodies of the saints which slept. Those that were dead arose. After his resurrection, they come walking through Jerusalem, the holy city. Imagine that. Imagine a guy coming home from work, passes somebody, says, hi. Shalom, shalom to you. Who are you? Have I seen you before? Do I know you? Yeah, you ought to. I'm Abraham. Abraham of who? Abraham of Ur of the Chaldees, but now I'm lately of Hebron. Abraham? That Abraham? That Abraham? Well, yes, that Abraham. I can see him as he turns white as, well, white as a ghost. Abraham's not a ghost. He's there, his body. I can see him running home, scared to death. Trying to tell his family, guess who I saw? Guess who I saw downtown a while ago? Abraham. Somebody says, well, that ain't nothing. Old Jacob, old Joab over there, he saw Jacob downtown. What? Are you kidding me? Yeah, said he shook hands with him. You kidding? Oh, no. The Bible says they saw the saints. They saw the saints. Oh, but then the miracle, I hasten to of the soldier. The Bible says in verse 54. Now when the centurion and they who were with him. Now notice that. How the Bible says it. We read words, we overlook words. Watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things. What things? Probably the things I've just mentioned to you. That were done. They feared greatly. Now that was something. Why is that something, preacher? That was something for centurion soldiers or Roman soldiers, especially a centurion. Centurion meaning he was over at least 100 men had in his command. So here's a soldier. I don't know if there were 100 with him. Probably not, but he had a good consensus. He had a good contingent there taking care of this situation there in Jerusalem of what he was assigned to. They're watching the crucifixion. They're taking care of business. You study the life of a Roman soldier back in those days. It was amazing. No telling where he was from. The Bible doesn't give us the details of his life. He's growing up probably in some other part of the Roman territory, and he's like some other kid that would go to the circus. Instead of going to the circus, though, he's going to the Colosseum to watch as they make sport of other people and put them to death. That's how he grew up. Going down the Colosseum, watch them bring them out. The gladiators, they'd fight to death. They'd watch as they put them down, and then they'd watch as the victor would put his foot down on the one he has beaten and look up to Caesar to see. And if Caesar hold out his hand, the crowd would cheer. And if Caesar said, thumbs down, they'd watch as he killed him right there in front of everybody. No regard for life. And boy, he'd hear the cheers as a boy. He'd watch that excitement. He'd think, I want to grow up to be a Roman centurion. I want to grow up to be a Roman guard. I want to be a Roman soldier. That's what I want to do. So he's watched. He's gone over and grew up to become that very thing. Now he's got his orders. The day has come. He's been called up, commissioned. Where's he going? Why, he's going to Palestine. Oh, Palestine. I don't want to go to Palestine. Well, I've been to other places. Well, at least I can go to where? I can go to Palestine. I can go to Caesarea Philippi. Oh, that'd be nice. I've been there myself. It's pretty nice. Even the ruins are still nice. Right there on the sea, the Mediterranean Sea, how beautiful it is. He gets there. He has marching orders to go to Jerusalem. Oh, no, I hear there's an upcry out there. I hear there's all kinds of things going on at Jerusalem. I don't want to go to Jerusalem. He goes to Jerusalem. He gets his orders. There's things going on over there with these of the way. So he gets his orders. And this particular day, he goes to work. He gets there that morning, and they say, "We have three to crucify." Three? Yes, three. Two of them are thieves, robbers. There's one who has claimed, they say he's claimed to be a king. And he speaks up right quickly and says, "There's not but one king, that's Caesar." Oh, yeah. Well, we want you to make sure he knows that. And boy, did they ever. They mocked him, they ridiculed him, they plucked out his beard, they put on a crown of thorns and squished it down to where the blood ran out of his head. They put on a purple robe, mocked him as, "You say you're a king, what you a king over now?" And then they carried him to that hill and they watched him. They nailed him to that cross. And the Bible says in the last miracle of this verse we're looking at this morning, when the centurion and those that were with him saw, watching Jesus, the earthquake, when this man died, something happened. They'd been watching this man. They'd seen this man. He's not like these others that we crucify. But when we nailed him down, what happened? He said, looking at them in compassion, and he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." They had heard the other sayings of the Lord on that cross. And they had watched as he cried out. And they had watched the earth go dark. And they had watched all these things happen. They said, "Something is different about this man." And this centurion, those that were with him, feared greatly. Something happened in their heart. Something happened in their life. And they said, "Truly, this was the Son of God. Truly, this was the Son of God." You see, something happened in his life. Has something happened in your life? Has God opened your heart to see who Jesus really is? Have you experienced real salvation? Has God called to you? By faith you have trusted the Lord as your only hope of heaven. Lifted up was he to die. "It is finished," was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high. Hallelujah. What a Savior. What a Savior. That's him. You know him today if you trusted him. Is he calling to you today? Let's stand for prayer. Father, I want to thank you for these miracles. I want to thank you, Lord, for showing them to us, helping us see them today. I pray, Lord, if you call to someone today, they will be obedient to your call, answer your call. Lord, I pray that you'd have your way in this invitation time. You know the needs and lives and hearts of every person. Help us to be obedient to you. In Jesus' name, amen. We're praying today and we're singing today. If God's leading you this way, you come. You may need to come and pray. You may want to come and join our church. God's leading you this way, you come. Whatever God's telling you to do in this service, this invitation time, you be obedient to God, will you? While we sing, you come.
Jesus is passing this way.
Amen. Amen. That's right.